We are posited in a society today that is undergoing a phenomenal process of change, widely caused by the interpenetration of several forces of modernity on the one hand and traditionality on the other. Within that, there has been a whole process of sustenance of inequality, environmental degradation, and also penetration of the new forces. To discuss some of the forces of modernity, change and developments, and its encounter with environmentalism, we are having among us today Professor M. N. Panini, a reputed professor in the Jawaharlal Nehru University. He is known for his contribution in the study of social inequality, change and development. I, on behalf of the student and on behalf of the sociology faculty of Indira Gandhi National Open University, welcome Professor M. N. Panini among us.
Thank you.
Before we go further in our discussion, I would like to ask a very simple question to Professor M. N. Panini. How does he look into the relationship between environmentalism and modernity in today's context?
It's a very significant question that you have asked, because environmentalism in some ways is posing a challenge to modernity. It's not necessarily a challenge, but it is, in the India, especially in the Indian context, is posing a challenge to modernity. Because environmentalism questions the very idea of science, the very idea of progress, the very idea of development. It now, you know, environmentalists have been asking questions about whether we are actually developing at all, or is it that we are, you know, living at the expense of our future generations. So in this context, environmentalism can be regarded as anti-modern. But yet, I want to emphasize, there is also a segment of environmentalism which is considered, which is this scientific environmentalism. And this segment of environmentalism is not necessarily anti-modern, right? But having said that, the main question is, what is modern? That is a very difficult question to answer, because for me, modernity is linked to the rise of science, the enlightenment, the rise of science in the modern world. And what has happened today is that we have lost faith in science. We have lost faith in the notion of objectivity. So as a result, there are many people, many environmentalists, who are questioning whether modernity is, you know, they say that modernity is a, you know, ideological tool to establish political hegemony, to establish some neo-colonial, you know, power relations and so on. And if you look at it this way, modernity is just a project. It is not really an overarching ideology which explains everything that we want to know about society or about other social processes.
How do you like to describe modernity? Is it a process or it is a project?
Well, you know, modernization is a process, right? Modernization need not necessarily be linked to modernity. Modernity is, you know, the adjectival form of modern means it refers to certain qualities, like, for instance, objectivity, the rule of reason, the faith in reason itself, the faith that through reason you can overcome social differences, and through using reason you can bridge cultural differences. Now, this was the core of modernity, all right? Modernization does not necessarily refer to the carrying forward of these ideals, all right? Because this happens because in modernization, when we are talking about modernization, we are referring to processes that are generated by, you know, this kind of rationality, which does not necessarily lead us to the bridging of cultures. In fact, it widens, you know, cultural rifts, it widens rifts between classes and so on. So modernization, I think, the process of modernization should be looked at from a different perspective, from the idea of modernity, which I think is a myth. Because, you know, I'm using the term myth in the way in which anthropologists talked about myth in studying, you know, primitive society, so-called primitive societies. Because when the anthropologists talked about myths, they said that these myths are very important to provide social cohesion, to ensure that people all, or you know, different segments of the society adhere to a set of norms and rules, right? And it's also a question of this myth also performed a political function of stabilizing roles and making people feel happy with the roles that they're assigned to in society. It may be iniquitous role, but a myth performed the role of stabilizing society by telling people that this is all, these roles are essential and these roles are important, and you have a particular, you know, position in society, and so that they, you know, carry out those roles. So in this sense, modernity has become a myth in our modern societies, and modernity is used by the state to say that we are going ahead, we are developing, we are progressing, and so on. This is not just by the state in the developing societies, also in the developed societies, they think they're modern, and that sustains that social order.
What kind of encounter those societies are having with the whole modernity project?
Let me answer this question in two parts. I belong to a generation which is convinced in the idea of modernity, in the idea of modernization and development, right? But today's generation, you have to explain why you are modern, right? Because for us, I belong to the generation, when I was a student, I was told in so many numerous ways that if you are objective, if you are scientific in your approach, if you apply reason, you can solve all problems, all right? Today, many critics of, you know, the development of underdevelopment theorists onwards, many have pointed out that modernity, this kind of a modern project, was actually an ideological project of imperialism. Not just that, it's also, over time, we have discovered, it's also an ideological project of the state, you know, within the developing countries to establish its hegemony over the society, all right? So, to establish its legitimacy over the society, all right? To establish the power hierarchy that exists, all right? But today, just as people discovered that modernity is also a political project, science itself is a political project. It's based on, is a power game. What the scientific theories you establish are not necessarily theories that are proven beyond all doubt. That there are, you know, very many areas of, you know, fuzzy areas in science. Considering this, now the legitimacy that science and scientists had has come down. Even today, the scientists have to look at what's happening to this genetically modified crops. What's happening is that the scientists are, you know, fighting a losing battle. In fact, the NGOs were, you know, many of the spokespersons of the NGOs are very articulate in expressing themselves, in expressing their opposition to the genetically modified, you know, crops. And even when the scientists have a good case for themselves, they cannot put it across as effectively as the NGOs. Look at what's happened to the Kudumkulam nuclear power plant project. You know, the government, I think, has a case which they're not been able to communicate to the people. But the people are convinced that this project is going to harm them. So today, modernity itself is a big question. That's why I'm saying that it's losing its legitimacy, and in its place, environmentalism has come.
So do you like to accept this view that environmentalism, in essence, is a protest to modernity?
is one of the protests, you know, against modernity. But especially in the Indian context, yes, you know, it's a kind of a, you know, if environmentalism in India, I think Indians' contribution to environmentalism has been very significant, globally significant. I think this has not been, you know, very well appreciated in the world of environmentalism itself. But I think Indian contribution to environmentalism especially is very significant. And the Indian environmentalists have rediscovered Gandhi, who was anti-modern. Essentially, he was an anti-modern personality. Anti-modern in the sense anti-modern civilization, right? So in this sense, Indian environmentalism is. But there are versions of environmentalism. You know, there is a thesis now being, you know, put across, the Anthropocene age, all right? This is the era of the men becoming like gods, you know, all right? The thesis is that men have become gods, all right? We have to realize that we are gods, then we can change things. And then these environmentalists say that we can, you know, combat climate change through technological, you know, modern technology. We can combat climate change. We have to, you know, they say, for instance, BT cotton technology, that genetically modified technology is the ideal thing for, you know, combating climate change. Climate change is the gradual global warming producing all kinds of other effects, like, for instance, the rise in sea level, right, the land area shrinking, the availability of sunlight, you know, dimming, you know, reducing, and areas where there was, you know, various, for instance, our monsoons are going to be hit very badly, they say, and the tropical countries will suffer from lack of rainfall, they'll become dry areas, and so on and so forth. And therefore, they say there will be all kinds of stresses, and the temperature will go up. And if we don't watch out, if we don't take precautionary measures, they say that, you know, why human life? All forms of life will be extinct very soon, within this century. That's what they say. This is what they call climate change. But then there are environmentalists, scientific environmentalists, who say that we can combat it through the use of science, through climate engineering, through biogenetic engineering, biotechnology. And so on, so on, biogenetic engineering. We have created life, artificial life. We have created cells, you know, bacterial cells, which have no known parent, you know. And they have, in fact, introduced in them the email addresses in the gene, in that genome. They have written out the email addresses of all the scientists who participated in the project. Right, so therefore they say that we have become gods. Right, this is, I think, in one way one can look at it as the height of arrogance, right, of humankind. On the other, in another perspective, you can say that, well, you know, this is the way it, you know, things are. We are going to move, and if you want to save the planet, if you want to save our forests, if you want to save our, you know, wildlife. And so on. Without wildlife, we can't exist. So, if we want to save the biodiversity, right, we have to do it in the scientific way. So, there are environmentalists are not necessarily opposed to modernity, but there is one strong stream of environmentalism which says that modernity is the cause of environmental decline.
The developed countries, they were over-consumed more than 40% of the natural resources. Mm. But the developing countries or underdeveloped countries, they have less consumed. Mm. However, in terms of CO2 emission, there is a quantum jump on the part of the developing countries in recent years, especially of China and India. But if you look at the world average, till now, India's contribution is quite less, but we calculate quite less in terms of our population and CO2 ratio. And despite all this debate, what happened, if you look at the inequality, the end recipient of the climate injustice are the people of the developing countries, especially the poor of the developing countries.
That's definitely true. But you know, this is a question which raises several what shall I say? You know, that questions of justice, and these are very naughty. These are some of the conundrums, as I call them. You know, these you have no easy answers. You know, as Bruno Latour, sociologist of the famous, the distinguished sociologist of science, he talks about compositionism. He says that we should all get together, we should all, you know, sit across a table and be sensitive to each other's, you know, cultural aspirations and cultural feelings, and come to some kind of an understanding so that we can move ahead, all right? But I think that is where the biggest challenge today for us is the fact that we may be gods in one sense, but we are still infants in terms of organizing ourselves with each other, relating to each other, so that we can sort of, you know, face these problems, these serious challenges that environmentalism is posing. And we can argue that you are, the West can say that the developing countries are guilty or vice versa, but this argument will take us nowhere. We have to arrive at a universal system of justice. I think that is the biggest question. That's why I think sociology is the key to the 21st century. I think it's only the sociologists who can provide these answers.
What is the relevance of environmental movement today in sustaining the issue of environmentalism? Is it a moral question or it is a substantive political question?
It is also a moral question. It's essentially, you know, if you turn around, I think most of the questions that we face are moral questions. Even among the climate change theorists who accept climate change, who accept that it's man-made, there are those who say that we have to take precautions right now, all right? And there are those who say that we still have some time. We still don't know how things are happening, you know, how climate is behaving. Our knowledge is still murky. But on the whole, even the IPCC, you know, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change also says the same thing, that, you know, it's sort of toned down its prognostications, and it says that it's likely that the temperature may rise by 2 or 3 degrees centigrade by the end of the century. So considering this, I was asking these IIT scientists this question: you are a scientist, tell me, who should I believe? He says, look, there is no person like Vivekananda. We want to have a person among scientists. We should have somebody who has the foresight to see.
How do you like to respond to this idea that world poor are the victims of climate injustice? They are the victims of environmental degradation and related issues.
If the poor are empowered, all right, they will be asking different kinds of questions. I'm not entirely convinced by this. There is an argument that there is a kind of a vision I have, but you know, the more I go to the West, the more I've seen of the West, what I admire much about the West is the fact that they have public goods, their post offices, their railways, their payments for people to walk on, right? And they manage their traffic properly. And look at all the public facilities, you know. There are these public goods, libraries. You know, I was amazed by the varieties of libraries that there are, and so accessible. Libraries are so well equipped. I think if we start thinking in terms of providing for public goods, you know, creating a structure, all right, which has more provision for public goods, then there'll be less need for motor cars and so on. Now, that is the real question is of social structure. How do we structure ourselves? Not just in one village or one city, or in one country, but globally. How do we restructure ourselves? If we restructure ourselves in such a way that we have, you know, what should I say, more of public goods, then naturally the demand for privatized goods will go down. There are several replications, you know, we are unnecessarily consuming, we are spending so much of fuel. If there is an arrangement by which the public transport system was good, we'd all be saving so much of carbon emissions. Similarly, on other things, on food, instead of burning chulas in so many families, households, if we can have a centralized place, we can save so much.
Three identities will remain in its own place. Number one, primordial identities in terms of caste, ethnicities. Number two, gender identity. And most importantly, the environmental identity. How do you like to respond to this?
No, you know, first of all, gender identity, I think there is a mix, you know, there is now a, there is male and female are not really binary opposites. There's a big borderline, you know, from male to female. Now, environmental identity, that's food for thought, because you can think of different kinds of environmentalisms, but ultimately, in order for the world to survive, you will have to evolve a compositionism. We have to reconstruct one particular ideology and, you know, social structure. And there will not be room for many environmentalisms.
Thank you, Professor Panini. Thank you very much for making an explicit expose on the issues of environmentalism and its interface with modernity. In our discussion today, we have discussed what do you mean by environmentalism, what do we mean by modernity, and what are the relationship between modernization and modernity, who is a project and who is a process. In between that, we have also discussed how the environmental sustainability can be used to explain and to counter the whole issue of modernity in today's context. Professor Panini has given several examples and also discussed the limitations of the modernity project and its relationship with environmentalism. Thank you very much, Professor Panini. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thanks. Yeah.